now we start the day number 3. Mm-hmm. And before we go ahead, you remember that yesterday I had given you some homework. What was the homework? Quickly, what was the homework?
Incoterms, and do it word.
Incoterms, okay. So how many of you have done Incoterms?
Sir, I have seen only one video on YouTube.
Good enough. Did you get anything out of that?
In that video, it is telling there are three types of something, cargo, sea, from sea and from land area and from air area. CIF karke wo bata rahe the, kuch usme tha, alag alag.
Okay. Any other person?
Yes, sir. Even I saw a video. As per the video, for international commerce business, we use the ICC. They used to form some standard common abbreviation of words so that there can be a smooth operation of business without any misunderstandings. And there are 11 such words which we have to follow. And these words, as per 2010, I think there are some amendments done. So it was 11 words after 2010. And this is a point of delivery is decided between the seller and the buyer. And the point of delivery says, till the point of delivery, the seller has the responsibility, risk, and the cost which he has to bear. And after that, the burden goes to the buyer.
So my idea was to introduce you to a concept which you have never seen before. So got an idea, right?
Yes, sir.
So in any case, I will cover the whole topic in one full lecture about the Incoterms. That is a quite big topic and it is relevant for exam. So I'll cover it up, right? So good that you covered up, and those who did not, for them, I'll tell only one thing. Self-discipline. Okay. I cannot introduce discipline. You are already grown up. You know the value of time which is going. Always see. Even if you have to compromise on sleep for half an hour, do that. But do not miss the work. Right? Everything else can come again, but the time lost will never come back again. Anyway, so we were talking about the Customs Tariff Act. The first thing that you must remember always, it is not Custom Tariff Act. S is there. Same is about the Customs Act. It is not the Custom Act. Customs Act. And this is also the Customs Tariff Act. And as we discussed in this, there are two parts mainly. One is about the provisions. Another is about the schedule.
Schedule.
Right? And in schedules, how many schedules are there?
Two schedules, sir.
Two schedules are there. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Schedule number one is for
import.
That is for import. And schedule number two is for
export.
Okay. Schedule number one is a big one. How many chapters are there in total?
98 chapters
are there. And in this, how many goods are there?
50 goods.
50
articles.
Effectively, it is 58, but the number is up to 50 only, right? Because alphabetical additions have been made in between. So effective number is more than 50. But if you go by serial, it ends at number 50. Okay. And the rules of interpretation, where those are given?
Article 1, Schedule 1.
In Schedule number 1, Rules of Interpretation. Right, because this itself is a big volume. And yesterday I had shown you complete Schedule 1. Where do you find Schedule 1?
It's in Tariff Act.
In the Tariff Act, Schedule 1. But if you want to check the tariff, where will you go?
So it's in cbic.gov.in.
Right. So remember these things that will help you in the long run. Okay. So for referring the tariff, you have to go to the cbic.gov.in. And there again, once again, I'll show you something a little bit. So everybody gets aware of what we're talking about. And then rules are also the part of Schedule 1. As far as rules are concerned, how many rules are there in total?
Six rules are there.
Rules of interpretation. Right? Rules of interpretation. Interpretation of what? Rules of interpretation of what?
For the classification of goods and assessment of duty.
You can say rule of interpretation for Schedule 1.
For Schedule 1, classification of duty and
of course. Schedule 1 is for classification and the rate of duty. Certainly, rules of interpretation, actually, this is a subject which comes in every law. And in general, if you Google rules of interpretation, you will find number of things there in rules of interpretation. So this rules of interpretation is only for the purpose of Schedule 1 classification, or you can say under the customs law. Okay, so rules of interpretation of Schedule 1. Of Customs Tariff Act. In total, there are 6 rules. And out of 6, how many we did yesterday?
Rule number 1
and rule 2A.
Rule 1 and rule
and
number
rule 2.
A. Okay. So what is rule number 1? Quickly. Do not refer notebook.
Rule number 1 is we are not supposed. I mean, heading is not any law. I mean, only the chapter and the section notes we have to go as per the section and the chapter notes, not the heading. Heading is not a law.
Anand, small error. Let us rectify it here. Section and chapter titles. Small error, okay? Section and chapter title. Section of which section? Section of the schedule. So section number, section title, and the chapter title, those are not the part of law. So classification cannot be based on those titles. Got it corrected?
Yeah, yes.
Anand, please confirm. I hope you got it right.
Yes.
Okay. So rule number 1 says section.
Chapter title.
Chapter titles are not the part of law. So something which is not the part of law, classification cannot be based on that. Right? So classification has to be based on the entries in the tariff.
Subheading.
Heading, subheading, subheading, explanatory notes given therein. Those are law. So classification has to be based on the entries in the schedule under the description. So description is having heading, subheading, etc. You can say it is so the classification has to be based on a heading, subheading, subheading, etc. plus explanatory notes. And as long as classification can be done as per this rule, any other rule need not be referred. That is also important. So if you can classify here, do not go to any other rule. So I'm using the classification . Please keep everything noted. whatever I'm writing on the board, make it sure this is in your notebook. After the end of the class, you will have to read it at least 3 times. Okay, immediately today after the end, before you leave the chair, minimum 3 readings are required. So classification shall be based on heading. Subheading. Subheading. As well as explanatory notes therein. It is already there in a notebook. Right? This is a quick revision. And if you can classify the goods under rule number one, there is no need to go for any other rule. You can take a note here also. Add that also. So if the goods can be classified as per rule number one, there is no need to refer any other rule. So should I clear this? Rule number 2A. Can I ask from any specific participant? So I'll get to know whether they are just logged in or they are really participating.
The incomplete or unfinished goods.
No. I haven't. Let me ask the specific person. This will be answered by Bhavik. Bhavik, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir.
Okay. Now tell me, what is rule number 2A?
Sir, rule number 2A, the goods which are coming import in unfinished condition or the condition which is fully dismantled conditions and which have been received in India and then are being used for the manufacturing and maintain as the you had given the example of Mercedes which is being manufactured in Pune.
Okay, now I'm giving you some very specific words. Focus only on those words. Okay,
yes,
rest all you can add.
We can say incomplete and unfinished articles. This is what we have studied actually.
Unfinished,
incomplete.
Incomplete
articles.
CKD.
CKD and SKD connection.
SKD.
Articles. SKD.
Yeah.
Okay. It's now the most important word.
Essential characteristics.
Essential.
Characteristics.
Right. So if you remember this much, you can explain rule number 2, sub clause A to anyone. I hope you understand.
Noted, sir.
Okay. See, when we are reading, we'll have a lot to read, but we have to understand very few specific words. And if you remember those words, your revision is very fast. Okay. So at the end of all the rules today, you will find that all the rules can be revised within 3 minutes. 3 minutes time is required for revising the rules. Now, coming to rule number 2B. Rule number 2B. And for doing that, first I'll take you to the document and then we will come back here. This is rule number 2B. What this says, any reference in a heading to a material. What it is saying? Reference in heading or subheading?
Headings.
This is talking about headings only. Because the reference of subheading, sub-subheading, that is given under rule number 6. Rule number 1 to rule number 5, those talk about headings. Or rather, rule 2 to 5. If rule number 1, heading, subheading is there. Okay. But as far as rule number 2, 3, 4, 5 are concerned, they talk about headings only. Subheadings are referred in rule number 6. And very first, very good thing about rule number 6 is, it simply says determination of the subheading and sub-subheading. Is same principle applies as applied for determination of heading. So rule number 6 is just a copy of what is the rule number 1 to rule number 5. So here what is said is, any reference in a heading to material or substance shall be taken to include a reference to the mixture or combination of that material or substance with other material or substance. Any reference to goods of a given material or substance shall be taken to include a reference to goods consisting wholly or partly of such material substance. The classification of goods consisting of more than one material or substance shall be according to the principle of rule number 3. What do you get out of this? Have you read this? Read it quickly. Then I'll come to explanation. So what this rule is saying, any article is certainly made of some material. There may be one material, there may be a combination of materials, right? And classification can also be based on the material of which it is constituted. Say, for example, if we take example of tire, what are the main material used for manufacture of tire?
Rubber.
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 What is next? Nylon thread. It is there in the tire or not?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
If you cut, you see the white thread there, and that is nylon thread. Then there is a steel wire. It is only for understanding. You need not remember the same thing. Okay, only for understanding what is the meaning of this. So tire, this is manufactured with rubber, nylon, steel wire. Maybe some other components are also there, but mainly three are there. On the other hand, if you take a bucket, maybe to be more specific, a plastic bucket. In a plastic bucket, the main component is only plastic, nothing else. Isn't it? But the question is, if this is the case, tire, then under which category it will fall, whether it is a rubber material or rubber product, or it is a nylon product, or it is a steel wire product? Where it will go?
Rubber.
It will be a rubber product?
Yes, sir, because essential part of that tire is basically rubber.
No. In rule number 2B, the word essential doesn't come. Essential is important, rule number 2A.
It will be based on tire, sir, actually.
I'm coming to that. It will be based on tire, certainly. Right. Because rule 2B is saying, now once again, I'll show you the rule 2B so that now you will understand what is the meaning of that. What it says?
any reference in
reference to a heading to a material substance shall be taken to include a reference to mixture or combination of that material. Right. Now, when we say a rubber tire, so rubber is included therein. So it can be called as a rubber product. Plus, it is also having nylon. It can also be referred as a nylon product. Then it is also having a steel. It can be referred as a steel product also. Now, the problem is what should be the exact classification? So if there is a combination, certainly the classification has to be as per rule number 3. So rule number 2B actually is not a rule at all for classification. This is giving you a reason for understanding rule number 3. Why rule number 3 comes? Example is here, right? So when we say that there is a tire, main components are these three, under which category it will come? Because as per rule 2B, it can be classified as a nylon product, as a rubber product, as a steel product, but it is not true. Similarly, you take the plastic bucket. Now, plastic bucket, can you classify it as a plastic article? Same plastic is used for electrical gadgets also. Same plastic is being used for the kitchen gadgets also. And this is a bathroom gadget. Now, where do you fit it into? So everything made of plastic will not be considered as a plastic product. So this rule number 2B is giving you a number of questions so that you go to rule number 3 and then you will appreciate the value of rule number 3. Without creating a confusion, rule number 3 will not be clear. Right. So read the last line. What it says? The classification of goods consisting of more than one material or substance shall be according to the principles of rule number 3. So when it is more than one article, certainly, necessarily, it is rule number 3. Even if it is a single material, but multiple classifications are possible, then also it is as per rule number 3. Got this? So as such, rule number 2B is not a rule at all for classification. But so, this is a reason. This gives you a reason why rule number 3 should be referred. Now, coming to rule number 3. We will just refer and then I'll take you to the board and give you explanation. This says, when by application of rule number 2B or any other reason, goods are prima facie classifiable in two or more headings, classification shall be effected as follows. So when rule number 3 becomes applicable, applicability of rule number 3. Multiple classifications are possible as per rule number 2B. When rule number 3 becomes applicable. So unless there is a reason for multiple headings, multiple classifications of the same article, rule number 3 does not apply. So for applicability of rule number 3, it is important that based on rule number 2B, there are multiple classifications possible. For example, I gave you plastic bucket. Now, plastic bucket is only a bucket also. This is only a plastic also, and there is a plastic bucket also. There are three categories possible. Right. And other categories are also possible. So where you will put it, whether it is a kitchen instrument or it is a washroom or it is used generally, how it is classified. So number of classifications are possible. Same is about the tire also. Therefore, tire also number of classifications are possible. Where do you exactly classify? That depends upon where it is going to be used. So rule number three, this is having three parts. Rule number three is having three parts. That is called 3A, 3B, and 3C. Rule number three, clause A, clause B, clause C. Clause A is saying, a specific entry shall prevail over
general entry.
General entry. A specific entry in the tariff for an article shall prevail over general entry. Right? Rule number 3B says, if you cannot classify goods here, then 3B can help you. And otherwise, there is a possibility that goods are classified here and goods are classified here also. Rule number 3B says, based on most essential characteristic. Classification based on most essential characteristic. And rule number 3C says, later is better. Right. What does it mean? This will become applicable if there is a situation where multiple classifications are possible even when you are in rule number three. There is one classification here, another classification here. So actually where the goods shall fall. Then rule number 3C says, every article is having a numeric number. The entry which is falling later, goods will be classified under that category. Entry falling later in the numeric order. Okay, numeric order, not alphabetical order. In the numeric order, and the goods will be classified there. And so that is the last resort, actually, that you cannot classify goods as per the specific entry. You cannot classify the goods based on the most essential characteristic. Then you go and classify the goods as per this one. I hope you got it.
Sir, one question, sir.
Yes, please.
Can you repeat? Can you give one example on...
For everything I have to give you. Just wait.
Sir, essential characteristics in coming, one also.
For everything, I'll give you example. Just wait. Okay. So I'll take you to another place right now.
TB is look just similar to, I think, rule one.
Which one?
Rule one.
No. Rule one said, section and chapter title are not the parts of law. The classification shall be based on the headings. Heading, subheading, etc. Those are part of law. Nothing else.
But essential characteristics also mentioned there.
Yes, most essential characteristic is rule number 2A. If essential characteristics of the unfinished incomplete goods are same as those of complete and finished goods,
then 2A, not one, 2A.
Sir. Yes, right. But that is for incomplete, unfinished CKD, SKD goods. Okay, this is not about partially or incomplete goods or CKD, SKD goods. So I will take you to this site. Which site is this? Take a note of the name.
DMT.
What is the name of this site?
Indian Trade Portal.
IndianTradePortal.in. Okay. Now see here. Yesterday I was telling you how to identify, how to find the tariff entry. So this is for reference. In general, if I put it, automobile tire, what happens? See how many entries are there. Right? So if you put a general heading, what will happen? There are reason for number of confusions. Right?
Yes, sir.
How many entries are there?
Lots of entries, sir.
Lots and lots of entries. That's why rule 3A says go for a specific entry. Right? Now I'll take you to going back, and now here if I put bicycle tire, what happens? How many entries now?
Six.
Right. Earlier, how many entries were there?
Lots of entries earlier.
Lots and lots of entries. I became slightly specific. Instead of automobile tire, I came to bicycle tire. Right? And things got substantially reduced. Now, further going back, again, I will be more specific. This is tubeless bicycle tire. What happens?
Only two.
Right. Now you can read the more details and go into the specific. Right. So when you refer the tariff exactly, you will find more details therein of a kind used for bicycle tubeless tire. And this is new pneumatic tires of the rubber of a kind used on bicycle, multicellular polyurethane tubeless tires. So that is a material used for manufacture of the tire. So if it is manufacture of the multicellular polyurethane, it will come here. Otherwise, it will come under this category. So how easy it becomes to classify the goods correctly? Right. You have seen the example of general classification and specific classification. I hope you got the idea. Right. So those who are having an additional computer right now, they can try it. IndianTradePortal.in. And try any product. Okay. Now see here. Let us take another example. If I put coffee, what happens?
Again, lots of, sir.
See the number. What will happen if you use something general? Okay. And now be specific about coffee beans. What happened? Earlier, how many were there? 129. Right. Now you have a specific. One is coffee beans and another is Robusta coffee beans. So Robusta is another category. If it coming here, it is there. Otherwise, in general, it will fall into this category, coffee beans. So as per rule number 3A, if a specific entry for an article is there, then goods shall be classified under that heading only. Right? Even there is only one component. I said coffee beans. Now coffee beans are there, but you cannot classify it as a coffee. Because coffees of hundreds of categories, 129 classification headings, you have already seen where the coffee word has been used. And we have made quite possible the article imported is the only coffee beans. Right. So if you go for general, some error is possible. And if error is there in the classification, what will go wrong? The rate of duty can be higher or it may be lower. If the amount of duty is wrong, later on the demand will come. And later on, you have to pay along with interest and quite possible penalty is also demanded. If excess amount has been paid because of wrong classification, there is no refund because the assessment is done by importer or by the CHA. So if the wrong classification has been done, there is no refund. If you pay less, there is always a risk of demand coming later, and then you have to pay interest plus penalty also on that account. So correct classification becomes very, very important. So now tell me, somebody was asking some example. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
First, what is said is specific entry will over general entry.
General entry.
Okay. Now you read the rule number, rule also. Now read this rule. What it is saying? The heading which provide the most specific description shall be preferred for the heading providing the general description. However, when two or more headings each refer to only part of the material or substances contained in mixed or composite goods, or to part only of the item as in the set put of retail sale, those heading are to be regarded as equally specific in relation to those goods, even if one of them gives a more complete or precise description of the goods. So this is the second part they're saying. So even if there are multiple classification, both can be treated equally. So first important thing is the most specific description that shall be preferred. Now read this one. What this says. Mixture of composite goods consisting of different material or made out of the different components, and the goods put up in the set for the retail sale, which cannot be classified by reference to A, shall be classified as if they consisted of the material or component which give them the essential characteristic, insofar as the criterion is applicable. Right. Now, just I'm giving you example for this one. Goods put up in set for retail sale. Okay. So when you buy potato wafers, what else comes with that other than wafers?
Other than wafers, the packet is there. Packaging is there. Secondly, I mean, a lot of spices are there. I mean, only the spices are there. So, salt, spices, and...
Chalo, example badal dete. Let us take a pizza. And of course, pizza doesn't come under this category, but still I'm giving you example of pizza. When you buy pizza, what happens? Packing is there, lots of spices are there, and other things are also there, including ketchup and this and that. So many things are there. But everything is separately identifiable. Isn't it? Chili flakes, separately identifiable. Black pepper, separately identifiable. Cheese, separately identifiable. Cardboard box, separately identifiable. Everything is having a separate identity. But which is the main one?
Bread.
The main is only the real pizza. Whatever comes along with that is immaterial. So whether other accompaniments are there or not, pizza identity remains. Right? Take example for this kitchen ke masale. Agar aapne kisi bhi bazaar se khareede hain, to usme kya kya cheeze aapko mil rahi hain? Anything for that example. Not only these. Jo example aapke samne de raha hu, these are very very general examples. Right? So the spices which are used in the kitchen, when you buy those, right? So those spices are ready to use. There's certainly the packing material is there. And along with the packing is also the multiple packings can be there. Right? But irrespective of the quality of packing, number of packings used therein, the ultimate identity is based on what is contained therein. So the essential characteristic that determines. Right? Now take, for example, if you buy a mobile phone, and it is having all the features of a mobile phone except calling. Will it be called as a mobile phone? except for calling, it can be used for all the purposes the mobile phone is used. Can it be called as a mobile phone?
No.
It cannot be. Right, it cannot be. You see, there was a one very old story, Sony company Japan, Sony Electronics. They introduced one mobile phone with a very high-tech camera. And the basic purpose was camera having data connectivity so that images or the video can be transported immediately, or those can be shared immediately. Right. And they wanted to classify that as a mobile phone. Department challenged that it is not actually a mobile phone. The prima facie use is
camera.
Whatever is there as a mobile phone, that is only data connectivity, and the purpose is sharing of the images and the video taken on the camera. So that cannot be classified as a mobile phone. So the most essential characteristic, that is rule number 3B. And rule, what is in the rule number 3C? See here. When 3C will become applicable? First few words, when the goods cannot be classified under A or B.
Sir, just a small doubt.
Hmm?
When we were discussing, you put the example of Sony Electronics.
Hmm?
When we refer that, we are saying that it do not have a calling feature, so hence it cannot be declared as a, it cannot be considered as a mobile phone under mobile phone chapter.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, the concern department has verified the product and they had come to a conclusion that this cannot be declared on this specific code. But there will be n number of products which cannot be verified or which cannot be examined. So in such cases, how can we determine?
All the problems arise only when the things are caught. Otherwise, there is never any problem.
Okay. So, if it is not examined or undeclared as mobile phone, then it goes as it is.
So if you are already in the field, already working in the import export, you know how much this verification of the goods is done. Anybody who is actually in the profession?
Sorry, sir?
Anyone here who is actually in the practice?
Sir, me, sir.
Okay. So, what is the percentage of the verification of imports?
It's less than 10%, sir.
Less than 10%. According to me, it is hardly 5% actually. Okay. So, very few cases when the goods are actually examined or verified. Otherwise, whatever you have done, that is presumed that you are right. But you have to be correct, because later on you should not incur any liability, because once you are blacklisted, your profession as a custom broker is gone. Gone forever.
Understood.
Okay. So we cannot say, because that the chances of verification are very less, so we can go with the wrong classification, we can say pay the less duty. No, your professional ethics demand to be accurate every time. Right. Even if your client is required to pay on the higher side because of accuracy, do that, because you don't want to compromise with your career. The client or the customer will always ask you to do the wrong classification and pay the duty on the least possible, but never ever accept that kind of request.
Sir, better to leave the client. Sir, one question is there.
Yes, please.
So sequentially, as the rule 3C says, when the goods cannot be classified by reference to A and B, there shall be, it throws you to the next. When the goods cannot be classified by 3 or A or 3B, then we have to go to rule 3C.
Right.
The same sequence applies right from the beginning. The rules can be classified, product can be classified by rule 1, then no need to go for rule 2.
Correct.
If the rule 2, then if it cannot be classified by rule 1, then we have to refer rule 2A. Then rule 2B throws you to the rule 3, throws to rule 3. Suppose it is not classified. Then sequentially, we have to, apply this one by one rule. Am I right?
No.
It's not like that. 3B, no. A or 3B, 3 or, here the third one is written when the goods cannot be classified by 3A or 3B. But similarly,
if you have a specific entry, that prevails over the general entry. Okay, that is one. So classification already done. So if there is no very specific entry for the product you are looking for. Okay, number two. There is no one essential characteristic of the article, main article, right? So there is no main article as such. Then what happens? Then there are multiple classifications possible, right? So say, for example, you have imported a set of equipments, all electronic equipments, but for different purposes. One is used only for calculation, another is used for a score, for scanning, and third is used for the purpose of data storage, and fourth is used for the purpose of processing. So everything is electronic, but still it is possible that these are being imported as a set and no specific classification can be done for that. So what you will do is you will have all the classification, then go in the last, whichever is the numeric order, and classify all the goods under that category.
Yes, sir. My specific question was that, question you. What I'm saying is that it is written there that rule A and B, it's not classifiable under rule 3A and 3B, then you have to later is the better.
Yes.
Similar things applied to rule 3B, we can say that if the product is not classifiable under rule 3A, then you have to apply rule 3B.
No, it is not a sequence. Either 3A or 3B, either you have a specific entry or a specific or essential characteristic. Go by one, right? So that is why it is possible that you may have multiple classifications, because you have a specific entry also, you have a classification or a specific characteristic also. So that's why that the rule 3C is saying it is not possible under 3A or B, because there is under both the category there is a classification. So there is no sequence. One is certainly there. Then two is for incomplete unfinished article. Rule 2B is for the mixture. There may not be a combination. Then rule 3 automatically comes. So effectively, after one, it is directly rule 3 if the article is complete or finished. Rule 2 doesn't come in between.
Okay.
So now let us take another example. Suppose you have necktie, shirt, trouser. This is as a set. Is it a common set or not? Goods are sold in this kind of set or not? Necktie, yes, shirt, and trouser.
Yes, sir.
Common?
Yes, sir.
Now, whether entries for all these three will be same or these will be different?
Maybe different.
Certainly different. Right. But those are being sold together. How do you classify that? Even if you go by rule 3A, for everything there is a specific entry. Now you have three specific entries. What do you do?
3B.
As I understand, I mean, all the three will be classified separately.
No, if it is being sold as a set, you have to classify as a set only. Right. And if there is a confusion, just keep a thing noted. Refer section 19 of the Customs Act. Refer section 19 of the Customs Act. So we cannot classify the goods as separate.
But sir, here the rule 3A says that specific entry prevails over general entry.
Right.
It is all the three, it is sold in a one box or in a one set. Supposedly. I mean, case, but the specific entries for all the three is available there.
Correct.
So, I mean, it can be classifiable under the three, necktie, shirt, and trouser. but so set it is, I mean, retail, I mean, on retail, on a retail selling platform, it is a set, sold as a set. So that's why it is cannot be considered.
No, once it is cleared from the customs, thereafter what happens, Custom Act is not dealing with that. At the time of import, how the goods are there in, whether those are being imported as a set or those are being imported separately.
Okay. Now clear.
Okay. Now just to take a very simple example, 100 neckties, 100 shirts, 100 trousers. Or you say 100 sets of necktie, shirt, and trouser. What difference does it makes here?
It is separate and it is basically sets.
Exactly. These are sets. These, if the goods are imported this way, then for every article you can do the separate classification, you can change the duty. But if this is the situation, as per 3C, the goods will be classified in the last heading in the numeric order.
Like the dinner set. I mean, the dinner set.
Exactly. I mean, same is in the dinner set. Same is in the cosmetic set. Same is in the sports set. Wherever there is a set, this will become applicable always.
And this will be, sir, basically, we have to refer section 19, right, sir?
Yes. Right. So if you have custom set, refer section 19. Right. I don't think this is the time when I should go to section 19. I can show you there. But we will be killing the time. So time is already running out. Anyway, so this is rule number 3. Now, rule number 4. Before I go to rule number 4, a small logical question. If by chance you happen to import an article which is not referred in schedule number 1, what will you do?
Not referred in schedule number 1.
Most, I mean, the nearest one, I mean.
Why nearest, sir? Then it is treated as exempt.
No. Exemption is always a specific, duty liability is general. So unless any specific exemption is there, all imported goods are liable to duty.
Most near to that article.
Yes, this is rule number 4. I'm going to explain you. So before that, I need to give you the background. The background is that unless there is a specific exemption, all imported articles are subject to duty. In case of export, it is opposite. Unless it is mentioned in Schedule 2, there is no duty on export. Unless it is mentioned in the Schedule 2, there is no duty on export. As far as import is concerned, it is saying every article imported is subject to duty unless there is a specific exemption. Just opposite. Yaad rahega?
Yes, sir.
Ya likhna padega?
नहीं सर लिखना पड़ेगा ये तो बहुत ही एक्सेप्शनल बात है ये एक बार में क्लियर हो गया एक सेंटेंस में सर
ओके देखिए इसको छोटा सा एक चार्ट बना लीजिए शेड्यूल 1 एंड शेड्यूल 2 राइट You already know Schedule 1 is for import, Schedule 2 is for export. As far as Schedule 1 is concerned, we say every imported article is subject to duty. Unless there is a specific exemption. On the contrary, as far as Schedule 2 is concerned, this says unless there is a specific entry in schedule, all export goods exempt from duty. Noted. Anita Khandekar, आपकी आवाज मैंने अभी तक नहीं सुनी.
Yes, sir.
बीच बीच में थोड़ा सा इंटरेक्शन चलता रहेगा, इंटरेस्टिंग रहेगा, थोड़ा माहौल बना रहेगा, है ना? So keep on sharing what you have, or there is any doubt. Okay, so everyone, okay. I'm asking everyone actually. So keep participating. So participation helps. So this is what I was talking about. As far as imported goods are concerned, unless there is a specific exemption, there is an import duty. Now coming back to my old question, if there is no entry for an article in schedule number one, whether duty will be there or not?
Yes, will be there.
Duty will be there because this is. Yes. Unless there is a specific exemption and there is no specific entry in the tariff, what do you do? For that comes rule number four. So the basis of rule number four is this. Without understanding this, there is bound to be a confusion that if there is no entry in the tariff, there is no duty also. No. Every article imported is dutiable unless there is an exemption given. In case of export, it is opposite. All export articles are exempt from export duty unless it is included in schedule number 2. So rule number 4 applies for imported goods having no specific entry. How it is possible? Some article imported for which there is no entry in the tariff. Government keeps on amending the tariff very quickly.
Yeah, but still, there's a possibility that the newly introduced...
Exactly. R&D is always on, isn't it? R&D is always on. New inventions keep on coming in. But unless some article is brought to India, it is brought to the notice of the government that there is some new article, so the government is going to amend the schedule. So whenever there is a new article imported, which is not there in the tariff, still it is dutiable, but dutiability will come as per rule number 4. Okay, once it is done, then certainly it is noted by the government and next day notification will come in and the schedule gets amended. But first time, on what basis duty will be collected? Rule number 4 is giving the answer to that. Rule number 4 is saying, any new article. New article means what? Dear Mr. HP, पहली बात तो बेटा आपका नाम मुझे पूरा बताओ, मैं एचपी से मुझे कुछ नहीं समझता.
सर, माय नेम इज विनोद वाधवानी.
विनोद जी, अगर ऐसा कुछ भी रहा ना जो आपको समझ नहीं आया, लेक्चर के तुरंत बाद आप मुझे फोन करो, है ना? बिकॉज सिंपल रीजन कि यहाँ पर बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो हिंदी बिल्कुल नहीं समझते, उनके लिए कंफ्यूजन हो जाएगा. सो एनीबडी हु वांट्स एन अंडरस्टैंडिंग इन हिंदी इमीडिएटली आफ्टर द लेक्चर गिव मी अ कॉल, राइट? नॉट टुडे, इवन इफ यू कॉल मी टुमारो और द डे आफ्टर टुमारो आई विल एक्सप्लेन यू. ओके, सो दैट राइट इज देयर विथ यू. और जहां कहीं पॉसिबल होगा सर्टेनली मैं कुछ ना कुछ आपको एक्सप्लेन करता जाऊंगा. सो एनी न्यू आर्टिकल, न्यू आर्टिकल मीन्स which is not there in the tariff, shall be classified on the basis of most akin goods, AKIN. And the meaning of akin is similar. Any new article shall be classified on the basis of akin goods. Right. So some article is there in the tariff and the new article is somewhere similar to that. The classification will remain same. And quite possible whenever any such thing is brought to the knowledge of government, the next day notification is issued, next day or maybe next week, and article and the schedule gets amended. So you know why schedules are given in laws? General question. There is nothing to do with the customs. Why schedules are given in the law? Every law is having some schedules. Why the schedules are given?
Identify the goods. To identify the goods.
I said schedules are there in every law. Har law mein schedule hote hain. Kyun hote hain schedule? Wohi cheez act mein kyun nahi dal dete?
So that it can be amended at any point of time, I think.
You are absolutely right, but I'll give you a little more answer to that. If there is an amendment to the act, then it requires approval of the
Lok Sabha and
Parliament.
Parliament.
But for amending the schedule, what is required is
notification. Central only government notification approval
by the concerned department. Right. That's why all the things which are volatile in nature are given by way of schedules in all the laws. Those are not given as a law. Those are not given as a part of the act, main act. Because for amending the main act, you have to go back to the parliament, get the approval. And you know, there are a number of other things there in the parliament instead of this.
But sir, in GST, there is lots of notification and amendments very frequently. And they amend the law at any time, any point of time.
No, not law. Rules are getting amended. Rules are again the same as the schedules.
Okay.
Not the act. Rules are getting amended. Okay.
Schedules are just at any point of time.
At any point of time, rules and schedules, those can be amended by the respective department at any time only by issuing a notification. Okay. That's why as a student of law, you have to be updated with the latest notifications. And here I must tell you that when you prepare for Viva after the declaration of the result, just ensure that all the notifications issued 6 months prior to the date of the interview you have gone through.
How many notifications are there in 6 months, sir? Around?
Maybe 50, maybe 60, not more than that.
Okay.
Right. So, quite possible, they ask you only one question and you are updated. You answer that there are no next question. I've seen people coming out of the interview in 3 minutes. And they presume that they have been rejected. But actually, it has happened that they asked only one question and that is the latest question and he is having the answer and he gets the license. Okay. So this is another key. You have to be updated with the notification so that in any case, once you pass, then we'll talk about that. So when the goods are not referred in the tariff, how the goods are going to be classified? Here, the goods will be classified on the basis of most akin goods. So some goods in the tariff, which is having a resemblance, the goods will be classified on the basis of those articles. Is it clear? Amit ji, yes. For you it is something new.
Clear, sir.
Okay. So now moving to rule number five. Rule number five, that is relating to classification of
Vishnu, मेरी क्लास हाँ क्या चल क्लास चल रही है मैं करता हूँ तेरे को कॉल है ना ठीक
So classification of packing material. When packing material is required to be classified? Otherwise, we have seen that when the packing material has been used, then classification is based on the most essential characteristic. When packing material requires classification.
When the packing material is also having a reusable properties and it has some
no simple answer when packing material itself is the final product isn't it
yes
For a layman, it is a packing material. But for the manufacturer, that packing material itself is the final product. Isn't it? So this is required only where packing material is the final product.
So, some example of this?
Giving you number of examples. Why only one? Say, for example, your polythene bags. Now, polythene bag is a packing material or it is a final product for the manufacturer? Question to you. The manufacturer of polythene bags, how he is going to treat it? As a final product or as a packing material?
Final product.
It's a final product, sir.
For him, it is a final product.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The person who's going to use the polythene bags, for him, it is a packing material.
Exactly, correct.
Right. Take another example. Gas cylinder. The company which is manufacturing the gas cylinder, for it is a gas cylinder or it is a final product?
It's a final product, sir.
Final product they are selling. Right. Yeah. Take example of this glass bottles in which you get the soft drinks. It is a glass bottle. Or it is a final
product, sir.
Right. So packing material requires classification only when this itself is the final product. It is not requiring classification at the stage of use. Right. So when you buy a gas cylinder, right, do you really buy a gas cylinder or you buy the gas?
No. We are buying the gas.
Gas cylinder.
Gas. So we are both. Buying the gas, not the cylinder.
Yeah. We are buying the gas.
Right. Same thing happens with the soft drink bottles also.
Correct.
What do we buy? You buy soft drink. It comes in the bottle, which is returnable. Okay. So, how the classification of the packing material will be done? This is not based whether it is returnable or not, but the question is whether it is of general use or specific use. Specific use and general use. Right, glass bottles. You go to the market, you will find glass bottles, empty bottles are also being sold. General use. Every material which you buy in the market, maybe medicines, those are also in the glass bottles, but specific. Soft drinks in a specific bottle. So whether that packing material is for a specific use or it is general use. Right? Now, gas cylinder, when I say gas cylinder, there is a gas cylinder for LPG. There is a gas cylinder for oxygen. There is a gas cylinder for acetylene. Number of types of gas cylinders are there. Have you seen all those?
Yes, yes.
No.
Yes,
LPG,
sir.
LPG cylinder you have seen?
Yes, sir.
CNG cylinder?
Yes, sir.
That you have seen. Oxygen cylinder?
Yes,
sir.
Right, that also you have seen. Then acetylene cylinder, which is used for this welding?
Yes, sir.
Right. So everything is a gas, but every cylinder is different. Why? Depending upon the nature of the gas with which it is going to be used and how risky or dangerous it is. Depending upon this, the thickness, the weight, the size, everything differs. So when there is a gas cylinder, depending upon the utility, the shape and size changes. So when I say specific use, it is having a specific shape. Size, use. So such a packing material is classified under the heading of the goods with which it is used. So LPG cylinder and LPG both will have the same classification. Medical grade oxygen and oxygen cylinder both have same classification. Right? Jewelry boxes and jewelry will have same classification. Got it? General use. Based on material of its manufacture. So whether that is paper based or plastic based or rubber based or what kind of material has been used therein, depending on that, it will be classified accordingly. Because that is of general use. This is of a specific use. Now see here. First you see rule number 4. What did we talk about in rule number 4? Goods which cannot be classified in accordance with the above rules shall be classified under the heading appropriate to the goods to which they make the most akin. Akin means similar. Most closely resemblance or almost similar. Rule number 5, in addition to the foregoing provision, the following shall apply in respect to the goods referred to therein. This is saying the camera cases, musical instruments cases, gun cases, drawing instruments cases, necklace cases, similar containers specifically shaped and fitted to contain a specific article or set of articles suitable for long-term use and presented with the article with which they are intended, shall be classified with the such article when a kind normally sold therewith. The rule does not, however, apply to container which give the whole its essential characteristic. That is a different story. But ultimately, what is being said, it is for a long-term use and it is a specific shape, size, everything. Then it is coming under this category. On the other hand side, in B, it says, subject to provisions of A, above packing material and packing containers presented with the goods therein shall be classified with the goods if they are of the kind normally used for packing goods. However, this provision does not apply when the packing material or packing containers are clearly suitable for repetitive use. So when those are of repetitive use, those will be again be different, but otherwise the classification will be based on material with which those have been manufactured. So those may be classified only as a glass bottles only, right? So if that is of repetitive use, then where it is going to be used? And if it is a repetitive use, it will fall under this category. So this rule equally is applicable for accessories also. So there may be a question that how do you classify the accessories? So put a note therein that rule 5 equally applies for accessories also. parts and accessories, both parts as well as accessories. So this is, so we'll put a note. Rule 5 equally applies to parts and accessories. Now taking you to rule number 6, last rule. In rule number 6, this is talking about determination of subheading, etc. Etc. means sub-subheading or sub-sub-subheading, how those will be classified. So again, taking you to rule number 6. So here we have rule number 6. What it says. For legal purpose, the classification of goods in the subheading of a heading shall be determined according to the terms of those subheading and the related subheading notes, mutatis mutandis, to the above rules, on the understanding that subheading at the same level are comparable. For the purpose of this rule, relative section chapter notes also apply unless context required otherwise. What does it mean? This simply says same principle as contained under rule 1 to rule number 5. Same are applicable for determination of subheadings also. Means whether there is explanatory notes or there is a principle given. So whatever is up there, the same thing will apply for determination of subheading also. So rule number 6 does not go beyond that. तो क्या मान लो आपको सारी चीजें समझ में आ गई रूल 1 से लेकर 6 तक?
रूल 5 थोड़ा सा कंफ्यूजन लग रहा है.
रूल 5 इज सिंपली टॉकिंग अबाउट ये पैकिंग मटेरियल को लेकर है, और अगर पैकिंग मटेरियल स्पेसिफिक तरह का है तो उसका क्लासिफिकेशन भी स्पेसिफिक होगा. जिस मटेरियल के साथ उसका उपयोग किया जाएगा उसका क्लासिफिकेशन भी सेम हो जाएगा, और यदि वो सामान्य पैकिंग मटेरियल है तो उसका क्लासिफिकेशन भी सामान्य ही होगा, और उस पर निर्भर करेगा कि उसको किस मटेरियल से उसका उसे मैन्युफैक्चर किया गया. ओके
ओके ओके.
सो जस्ट अ क्विक रीलुक, व्हाट इज रूल नंबर, लेट अस से रूल्स पुटिंग द हेडिंग. What is rule number 1? What is rule number 2? In 2A and 2B. Then we have rule number 3. In rule number 3, we have
3.
A, B, C. Rule number 4, rule number 5, and rule number 6. Okay. Now give me quickly specific words for rule number 1. Some specific words.
Title, not law.
Based on what?
Headings.
And chapter titles.
And the section notes. Or other notes.
Yeah, explanatory notes.
Okay. Only this much. Rule number 2A. This is?
Incomplete, knockdown, disassembled,
CKD. Incomplete, CKD. Unfinished, CKD, SKD. okay, this is combination. What is 3A?
Specific entry.
Specific entry. 3B.
Essential characteristic.
Essential characteristic. 3C.
Later is better.
Later is a better.
Later is better. Rule number 4.
3C मुझे क्लियर नहीं हुआ सर.
सर ये केवल ये कह रहे हैं कि आपके पास अगर मल्टीपल हेडिंग्स पे क्लासिफिकेशन पॉसिबल है किसी भी कारण से, यहाँ पर किसी वजह से हो, इस वजह से हो या सेट की वजह से हो, किसी भी कारण से अगर मल्टीपल क्लासिफिकेशन पॉसिबल है, जो भी न्यूमेरिक ऑर्डर्स आपके पास मिल रहा है उसमें सबसे लास्ट में जाकर उसको खत्म कर दिया जाएगा. तो दिस इज कंसीडर्ड एज अ लास्ट रिसोर्ट. सब कुछ तो आपने कर लिया. रूल वन
न्यूमेरिक ऑर्डर मींस मतलब जो हेडिंग सब हेडिंग और वो सब है
उसमें जो नंबर दिए हो ना, हर चीज के लिए एक नंबर है, हर आर्टिकल के लिए
नंबर.
नंबर वन
जो हेडिंग्स हैं ना.
अच्छा अमित जी आपका क्वेश्चन है तो मैं आपको बताऊंगा थोड़ी देर बाद, मैं आपको बताता हूँ जब लेक्चर के बाद कि वेयर डू यू फाइंड द नंबर्स. ओके मैं आपको बताता हूँ उसके बाद, बिकॉज दिस इज योर फर्स्ट टाइम. यस्टरडे वी डिस्कस दैट. एनीवे रूल नंबर 4. रूल नंबर 4 के लिए एक शब्द दीजिए.
स्पेसिफिक एंट्री.
नो.
अकीन. अकीन प्रोडक्ट.
अकीन.
अकीन प्रोडक्ट.
रूल नंबर 5.
पैकिंग मटेरियल.
पैकिंग मटेरियल्स.
स्पेसिफिक
एंड जनरल.
जनरल. रूल नंबर 6. सब हेडिंग. सब हेडिंग और
सब हेडिंग.
राइट. So how long it takes you to revise the 6 rules? Tell me quickly, how long it takes you to revise the 6 rules?
5 seconds. Just, we have to see this chat.
That's it. See, जो भी टाइम लगना है एक बार में लगना है, समझने में लगना है. Once it is understood, आपका पूरा सिलेबस मैंने कहा 3 घंटे का, मैं आपको बताऊंगा 30 मिनट में कैसे होता है. The whole syllabus can be done within 30 minutes also. Okay? Can I clear this?
Yes, sir.
अब शुरू करते हैं कस्टम टैरिफ एक्ट. हालांकि ज्यादा समय नहीं है, बट यस वी शुड स्टार्ट समथिंग. सो इन एनी केस वी वर यूजिंग द सेम मटेरियल एंड आई एम टेकिंग यू टू द हेडिंग. सो द कस्टम टैरिफ एक्ट इज हैविंग 13 सेक्शंस इन टोटल. सेक्शन 1 नीड नॉट बी डिस्कस्ड. सेक्शन 2 कैन बी अंडरस्टूड ओनली इफ यू नो सेक्शन 12 ऑफ द कस्टम्स एक्ट. Section 12 of the Customs Act is the charging section. If Section 12 is not there in the Customs Act, the whole law does not exist. Every tax law will have one charging section. Every tax law, right? So this tax law, Customs, is having charging section. That is Section 12. Okay? Now Section 12, this says, except as otherwise provided in this act or any other law for the time being in force, duties of custom shall be levied at such rate as may be specified under the
Customs Tariff Act
or any other law for the time being in force on the goods imported into or to be exported in from India. And subsection 2 says the provisions of section 1 shall apply in respect to the goods belonging to government as they apply in respect to the goods not belonging to government. What is the meaning of these lines?
Equal rule applies to government, this thing, and as well as the normal public.
Exactly. Actually, this subsection 2 is just an explanation to subsection 1. It is not a separate subsection altogether. Because subsection 1 is simply saying all the goods are to imported or to be exported are subject to duty as per the custom tariff act. So there is no specification whether goods belonging to government will be treated differently. But number of issues were raised after the implementation of the Customs Act, that whether the goods belonging to government are subject to duty or not. because the government is paying duty to government, right? So whether it is right or wrong, if the goods are being imported by the government, then government is paying duty to government, whether it is correct or wrong.
Correct.
It is not correct. It is indirect tax. The goods being imported by the government, when the government is paying the tax, the burden of tax will be passed on to somebody else who is going to consume the goods. Isn't it? Government is not the consumer. Right? Say, for example, if the goods are imported for the purpose of defense, then government gives an exemption, then there is no tax. But goods being imported otherwise by the government and then the tax being paid by the government to government, that is an indirect tax. It means the tax paid on import will be passed on to the consumer. So there is no tax which the government is paying to government. Subsection 2 simply saying whether there is an import or export by the government, the same provisions will be applicable. So this is just an explanation to subsection 1. Subsection 1 is saying the duty of the custom duty shall be levied. Okay, so for the time being enforced, at which rate? At such rates as may be specified under the Customs Tariff Act. So this one, section 12, is talking about which tax, which duty?
Custom duty, sir.
Custom duty. Now, how many types of custom duty is there?
This is talking about only basic custom duty.
Basic custom duty, right? Now, read subsection 2 here. The section 2 says, this is the section 2, this is custom tariff act, right? This I kept intentionally within the parenthesis so that you understand that this is customs act and here we have come back to custom tariff act. So here it is, the rates of which the duties of customs shall be levied as per customs act are specified in the first and second schedule. Okay, now bringing you back here.
Sir, before we proceed, one small question is there. Can you just explain once again, I mean, section 12 of Custom Act, subsection 2 of section 12 of Custom.
Correct. Section 12.
Subsection 2.
Okay, what subsection 1 is saying? Custom duties.
I have to refer custom duties. I mean, it gives the power. Custom Tariff Act is from the power of section 12, if I'm not mistaken.
Only section 2 of the Custom Tariff Act. Remaining sections have no reference with the Customs Act.
Okay.
Only section 2.
Custom Tariff Act draws power from section 12 of the Custom Act.
Custom Tariff Act, specifically section 2, derives power from section 12 of the Customs Act. Remaining sections of the Custom Tariff Act have no connection with the Customs Act.
Okay.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8A, 8B, section 9, section 9A, remaining all the sections, they have no connection with the Customs Act. I'm going to explain you that. Okay. So, custom duties on import and export. As per custom tariff act. Right? And subsection 2 says, provisions of subsection 1 are equally applicable
if the goods imported by the government
for import or export of goods by government. So as far as subsection one is concerned, this is not making any distinction who is the importer, who is the exporter. Subsection one is simply saying any goods import, any goods export, pay the duty as per Custom Tariff Act. Right. In a subsection two, it says same provisions are applicable even if the import export is by the government or on behalf of the government. I hope it is clear.
Yes, this is clear. Then further you give the example that the government are not subject to tax because it will be passed to the ultimate consumer. So
right.
Here it's a contradiction.
No. Just understand one thing. What is the meaning of indirect tax?
GST. Borne by the other person. Finally, it is recovered from the consumer.
Finally, it is recovered from the consumer, right? So, say for example, the government has imported food items. Maybe you can say the edible grains imported by government. Okay. And who's going to consume?
Yeah, general public.
Public is going to consume. Right. So, the tax paid by the government on import of grains will be passed on to the consumer. It is not the government is paying the tax to government. Government is paying, but it is going to recover that amount of tax from the public. Right? And government is having a right to fully exempt their goods. So when goods are imported for use by the government, a full exemptions are given, but by way of notification.
Okay.
As far as section is concerned?
Yeah, exemptions are given. That's there. I understood now. Now I understood.
Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, when we say custom duties, so custom duties are governed by Custom Tariff Act. In Custom Tariff Act, we have schedules. Schedules, you already know, schedule one is for import, schedule two is for export. Okay. Then there is section three. Right, I need to make a small list, so just I'm clearing this. You can keep on writing below that. So section three provides for additional custom duty, then a special additional custom duty. Section, then IGST, right? Section 6, this provides for protective duty. Section 8B, this provides for safeguarded duty. Section 9, this is duty against subsidy. Section 9A, this is anti-dumping duty. Right. There is no reference of these duties in the Customs Act. Customs Act is only talking about basic custom duty. Is this clear? Customs Act is only about basic custom duty. Remaining other duties are as per the Custom Tariff Act. Clear? Or there is a doubt? Tell me quickly. So I believe there is nothing to ask.
BCD is basically custom act, and remaining custom duty is basically from governed from CTA.
Yes. Customs Act deals with basic custom duty only. Remaining duties are under the Custom Tariff Act. Right. Now, today itself, I had forwarded one document which talks about the social welfare cess.
Yes, sir.
Social welfare cess is as per the Finance Act 2018. There is no reference of that either under the Customs Act or under the Custom Tariff Act. Okay. So there are different provisions applicable on the same thing at the same time. So this is all about the rules of classification, and the detailed description of the Custom Tariff Act will take up tomorrow.